I would like to present you the results of our research on Bronze Age oaths carried out in the region of Salins-les-Bains in Franche-Comté, in eastern France. Salins is located in a steep head valley created by the Furious River. It is an important crossing point between the plain of the Saône and the Swiss plateaus. The exploitation of salt springs have also been a factor of dynamism of this region during the end of the prehistoric period. And the sector is occupied by several hilltop settlements during the Neolithic and the early Bronze Age. But the Camp du Château is the only one hill-fort settlement occupied during the transition from the Middle to the Late Bronze Age in this region. So it certainly controlled the wall sector in this time. Completing the study of the site, field surveys have been realized with metal detector since the beginning of the 2000s, as systematically as possible, in a legal framework and under scientific control. This allowed us to study the roads in exceptionally good conditions. Since we have precise information on the topographic environment of the finds, their modes of deposition, their composition, and their regional distribution. Actually, 63 roads were discovered, spread very broadly around the Camp du Château, which is here. Most of them date from its main phase of occupation. It is to say the end of the Middle Bronze Age and the first phase of the Late Bronze Age. There are several arguments in favor of a symbolic interpretation of these oaths rather than of an economic one. Even if some oaths could be considered as small metal stocks, but of no more than 9 kilograms, which is very little, many of them are extremely small, you can see 21 grams only, and poor, and could not be identified as stocks nor as treasures. We can observe a possible intention to personalize these assemblages by adding some objects that may represent an individual. Besides the foundry, series of cycles and of axes, there are often a weapon, a tool, some small ornaments that could represent a person. Some of the rods containing jewelries are quite prestigious, as we can see for this gold ore of Protin. Some ores also contain symbolic objects, as these representations of ducks that are known to belong to the mythology of the Bronze Age. Finally, the Bronze Age people spent a lot of time fragmenting and deforming the objects carefully, which would be a way to make them unusable in order to change their value and to consecrate them. There is also symbolism in the gesture of the deposition itself. For the pins of the old one of Bois Bovard, it corresponds to a real stage setting. Two identical pins, folded in the same way, stuck into the ground side by side, the head and the tip down, between two prominence blocks. Great care has also been taken to stick the objects of the Ode of Cesnay in a rock fault, perhaps giving this gesture a ritual character. So it's also interesting that the objects were discovered most often scattered on some square meters, and they were buried at a very shallow depth. Sometimes they even slipped on the slope. It is as if they were not really buried, but rather thrown away, or if they had fallen from a high stand, now disappeared, maybe a tree or a wooden structure. They were also often deposited in symbolic places, close to easily identifiable natural elements in the landscape, large rocks, like here, standing stones, clusters of blocks. several holes were deposited on the Mont-Poupée, or as it foot, which dominates the whole area and from which even the Mont Blanc can be seen on a clear day, which must have had an impact on the minds of the Bronze Age people. Its presence is very impressive. It is a landmark. The location of the old seems to have been chosen in a very precise way, taking into consideration not only their immediate environment, but also their position in the landscape. The places chosen in the topography are very particular. Edges of plateaus, ridge lines, cornices, slope wakes. It is observed quite clearly on the topographic map of the site, as you can see the odds on the topographic lines. We chose to test the visibility of the places of hoarding from the various elements constituting the cultural and social landscape of the sector. These analyses were performed in a GIS with a 25-meter resolution digital elevation model. We first tested the intervisibility between the places of hoards. Indeed, thanks to the topographic choices made, it is possible to see a large number of other places of hoards from each of them. As you can see for the hoard 14 of Cotin here, a lot of other hoards are in its area of visibility. And it's the same for the hoard of Cesnay. First, we see the existence of a real network of visible relationships that interconnect the different areas of hoarding surrounding the Camp du Château and the valley. It can also be seen that the deposition sites around Salins are almost visible, all visible from both the Mont-Poupée and the Camp du Château. It's the dark green areas here. So there is also a very complex network of visual relations between the hordes and the different hilltops, which are the most important elements of the social and cultural landscape. The Mont-Poupée, which due to its dominant position had to exert a strong impact on the minds of the inhabitants of the valley. The Camp du Château, where important people have certainly exercised a social and economic control of the valley, but also the older hill fort that probably retained a role in the historical and cultural landscape. Yet this system of visual canvas does not concern every hoard. Indeed, several in the south and in the north, especially beyond the Poupée, do not have a direct relationship with the Camp du Château. They are differently oriented, as you can see for the hoard of Arwesh, that is turned towards the south. They seem to have another functioning than the hordes near the Camp du Château. Perhaps some of them could be related to another site, perhaps the site of Éché. The hordes integrated into this network of visual relations could therefore belong to the same territory, probably that of the Camp du Château. Identifying those who were surely connected with it and those who would be excluded, we can then propose an estimation and an approximate delimitation for the territory of the Camp du Château, which would be about 8 per 12 kilometers. But that's not all. The hordes were made voluntary on topographical limits like quests, and consequently on limits of visibility. Most of them are found in the first or the last 5% of the visible surfaces, rather further away than just on the borders. The hordes are not simply distributed all around Salins in visible places from the Camp du Château. They were especially placed along the main lines, delimiting the visible spaces and structuring the landscape. It's the yellow lines here, and the red dots are the hordes, of course. We will take a tour of the panorama to better understand the perspective seen from the Camp du Château. Here is the Camp du Château. We'll go on the top. You can see the age, the alignment of 17 homes along the edge of the Poitain Plateau. There's another cluster of homes along the lines here. And here. Here. Here and so on. We first note the good concordance between the position of the hordes and these lines structuring the landscape, as it's seen from the point of view from the Camp du Château. It's very likely that these visual borders imposed by the landscape delimited the territory controlled by the inhabitants of the Camp du Château on the margin of the Les Bons each. Hordes could therefore be the result of recurrent ritualist practices that could have a second objective, that of marking the landscape, and especially the limits of the territory, and perhaps to consecrate them, to circularize this territory. If we follow this hypothesis, this observation leads us to propose here a fairly precise modeling of this territory, with a total area of about 4,400 hectares. This example gives an idea of what could be the extent of a territory controlled by a hilltop settlement in the Bronze Age by implanting hordes as cultural markers on the perimeter of their territory. The Bronze Age communities have appropriated the landscape. They marked it because it was for them as much an environmental life as a social space. I thank you for your attention.